you see here are ones that we make. These enclosures, we purchased the enclosures, we installed these relay panels. This is the back of the panel, this is the front of the panel. Inside those enclosures, ship those to the end customer, and that building, if you, the next time you drive by the electrical substation, pay attention to what's inside that fenced-in area. You'll see a building like that, and that's what we call a control center, and that's where we control the flow of power in and out of that center. Now, the way this equipment works is, and this is a cartoon of the power grid. We've got the generating plant. We're going to transmit that power from the plant to a transmission substation. From that transmission substation, it goes to a distribution substation and into your home. Now, our equipment and those control centers are housed inside these substations. And the best example I can give for one of the functions that we provide is if you, the next time you're driving down the highway and you see a wind farm, you may see 30 turbines in that farm. And it's very rare that you'll see all those turbines turning. You might see five turning and 25 of them may be standing still. Well, what's happening with electric power, we have a limited ability to store that power. So we have to balance the generation with the usage. And what's happening is the demand for power at that point in time is not great enough to have all those turbines turning at the same time. So our equipment is monitoring that demand and that generation. And it says, okay, right now, it's in the middle of the afternoon, people are out working, they're not at home, so we only need 10 turbines running, and the others will shut off. One of the other functions that we provide is fault detection. In the case of a storm, if a tree falls across that power line, our equipment will detect that fault and actually shut the power off through that circuit. So, still don't encourage you to touch down the power line, but if a tree falls and it takes the power line down, it cuts the power to that line for that purpose, so that nobody walks up and gets electrocuted. Now, with that, let's talk about how I came to choose my career. So it began.
Wrong direction.
When I was in high school. Yep. It began when I was in high school working in a manufacturing plant. It was during the summer, and I grew up in a small town, about 15,000 people. We're a manufacturing town. There were a bunch of manufacturing plants around. So I was working in this plant, and one of the things that I noticed this guy who would walk around, and when he walked into an area, people would jump to attention. And it wasn't like they weren't working. It's just his presence just elevated. People just worked harder whenever he was there. And then I noticed him talking to people in the hallways and in the aisleways, and he was very authoritative. I mean, he was talking, and people were just really paying attention. So I asked one of my coworkers, I said, "Who is that guy?" And he said, "Oh, that's the plant manager. He's the big boss." So I said, "I kind of like that." So I'm there, I'm working, and he comes through the area I was working in one day. And I summoned up my courage, and I approached him, I introduced myself, told him I was, you know, getting ready to go to college, trying to figure out what to study, but I'd like to be a plant manager. What do I need to do to become a plant manager? And the first thing he said was, "You need to get a degree in industrial engineering." Later on, he invited me into his office, and he took the time to walk me through his career path. Where he went to school, what his first job was out of school, and he walked me through the path to him becoming a plant manager. He also showed me other positions within the company that utilized industrial engineers. From that experience, I went home, did some work, and it wasn't too long before I made the decision that I was gonna become a manufacturing plant manager and get an industrial engineering degree. So my first step was to find a career I like, and then I pursued the degree program that would best prepare me for that career. So that brings us to our first takeaway. Don't leave home without knowing where you're going. And career goals gives focus and determination, and it also helps you to overcome obstacles that might otherwise push you in a different direction. Now, once I finished high school, I went to enrolled in Mississippi State, and it was my first semester freshman year, and I was taking a typical engineering load. You take calculus, physics, a couple of humanities, chemistry, and chemistry lab. Well, chemistry was, in high school, that wasn't my best subject. And there was something about chemistry that just didn't click in my head. So I walk into this chemistry class, and mind you, I graduated from high school. My high school graduating class was maybe 190 people. So I walk into this chemistry class. It's an auditorium with 200 students in it. And I said, man, oh man. So I'm struggling through this course, and we were rapidly approaching the last day to drop a course without a grade. So I had to sit down and do some thinking. So my thoughts were, all right, I want to be a plant manager. In order to be a plant manager, I gotta have an industrial engineering degree. And in order to get an industrial engineering degree, I gotta complete 2 semesters of chemistry. So, reflecting back on my goal, I sat down and I said, you know what? I'm not gonna let this one course push me in a direction that I don't wanna go in. So I just buckled down and I said to myself, I'm gonna get through this course any way I can. And if I just survive it, then that just means I have to work hard and on some other course to make a better grade and end up to compensate for that. Yeah. So the point there, when I say don't leave home without knowing where you're going, make that career decision as early as you can. And one of the things that you can use to help make that decision, find someone who's doing a job that you want to do. And then ask them, how did you get here? What did you do? And one of the things I guarantee you you'll find is that people are very willing to share their success stories with you. So now, I've completed my undergraduate degree, and I accepted a job with the General Electric Company. And GE has this manufacturing management program. It's a very selective program, and it was designed to prepare candidates for high-level management positions in manufacturing. So I won a position on that program, and one of the things that I had to do was, again, talk to people, okay, what's the game? How do I get, okay, I've got my undergraduate degree, all right, that was the first step. Okay, now I've got a corporate job, I'm on a program with a path to my goal. It's a very competitive program. So, what do I need to do to successfully navigate this program to compete with all of these very, very smart folks, very talented people out there? Well, I worked 11 different, in the first 19 years of my career, I worked 11 different jobs, relocated 7 times, and this wasn't like moving from Des Moines to Kansas City. These were light pickup and rebuild their life relocations from Tennessee to Massachusetts to Syracuse, New York, to St. Louis, to Minneapolis. I mean, that was the game. You know, you saw challenging assignments. If they said, go to Timbuktu, you went to Timbuktu with a smile on your face. You did the job that you had to do. And so that brings us to our next takeaway. Learn the game and play to win. We don't make the rules. And that's the first thing you gotta face into. Once you decide on your career path, find out, okay, what are the keys to success? What are the steps I've got to go through? And do the things that are required to get you there. So, as a result of all of that, I landed a job at the age of 35. I won a job as a plant man. It was in Mankato, Minnesota. And not only was I managing a plant, I also had responsibility for design engineering, and I had a satellite operation that I had responsibility for down in Houston, Texas. So I'm 35 years old, and I'm working my dream job. I mean, life is pretty good. So I'm on top of the world, and everything is cruising along pretty good. I worked this job for 2 or 3 years, and I started thinking, okay, what's next? What's the next step? Well, the next logical step was a bigger plant in some other location, and then after that, maybe a headquarter job someplace, and then after that, you know, I'm sitting there thinking, at this time, I'm about 38 years old. So I got a lot of years in front of me. And what I'm seeing is my path forward is the same path that I've been on. You know, bouncing around, one challenging experience after the other. And the key with those challenging experiences is that there are risks that comes with those experiences. You get rewarded for success. You don't get rewarded for taking on a challenging job and failing. You get to go find another job.
Yeah.
There was risk along that path. And again, I sat down and did some thinking, and I decided that the path I was on wasn't the life I wanted to provide for my family. We had 3 kids at the time. One was about to enter high school, and I made the decision that I didn't want to play a game anymore. So that's when I made the decision to go on a national search to find a small manufacturing company that I could buy and run myself. So that brings us to our third takeaway. Make your home your sanctuary. Now, you've established these career goals, and the thing that you have to always understand is there is work. There is going to be, there's always going to be hard work, and you should expect to work hard. The other thing, and some of you may have heard this thing called work-life balance, it's a myth. It doesn't exist. Okay? You know, the best you can do is blend the two. But the fact of the matter is, you're going to make choices. And when you make those choices, not every need is going to get satisfied. So you need to really stop and think about what you aspire to be and what will life be like for you at that point in time once you achieve that goal. And the thing that I have to tell you is, climbing any ladder, looking to achieve any goal, there are pressures. it's your home. And if you're unsettled at home and you're having difficulties at work, it's impossible to perform at a high level when you got disarray on both ends.
Yeah.
So just kind of recap the key takeaways. Don't leave home without going for your own. Set your goals. The earlier you can set that goal, the better. Having those goals help you to overcome obstacles. It doesn't matter what career path you choose, there are going to be obstacles that you will have to overcome. And the thing that I've seen, and I think most of us have seen this, very, very smart, talented people who are unfocused, and they hit an obstacle, and then they turn, and they go this way, and they hit an obstacle, and they turn, and they just bounce all over the place, and 4 years comes and goes. They've done a lot of little, and haven't gotten enough to even complete their degree. So, don't leave home without knowing where you're going. Learn the game and play it to win. Okay? I think that speaks for itself. And my favorite is make your home your sanctuary. So I made that choice to step away from a very promising corporate career, to take a huge risk to buy a small manufacturing company and make it successful. That was 21 years ago, and it worked out pretty good. My oldest son entered the business about 18 months ago, and if things work according to plan, I'll be retiring to the farm in another couple of years.